These two United States Air Force pilots are preparing for a highly classified mission and will fly the fastest, highest flying aircraft ever, the SR-71. Unofficially known as the Blackbird, it's a long-range, advanced strategic reconnaissance aircraft. Today was just a routine, regular mission to fly their aircraft at high altitudes while gathering imagery on key Russian bases, such as the Soviet Navy's Northern Fleet on the Kola Peninsula. Today, something will go wrong. The Blackbird flown by Lieutenant Colonels Duane, Noll and Tom Veltri is a day they will not forget. The events of that day were only declassified in 2018. This is the story of how Sweden's Air Force Viggen fighter jet pilots saved an SR-71 and its stricken crew.
On the 29th of June, 1987, we were flying an SR-71 sortie through the Baltic. It was a pretty normal sortie that we'd flown many times before. However, on this day, we had a little problem. The right engine on the aircraft blew up, exploded, just as we were about to make our turn back to the south. We handled the emergency, going straight ahead for a few minutes, but then turned south. Airplane, although we started off at 80,000 feet, when we lost the right engine, we fell about 40,000 feet in less than a minute. Finally, we started our left turn back to the south and decided to head straight for Gotland Island, and because we knew we could be in trouble. And when I say that, the aircraft flies pretty good on one engine, but not at Mach 3 and not at 80,000 feet. So by the time we leveled off at about 25,000 feet, we were going about 380 knots, and we didn't know what to expect, but we thought we knew we could be in trouble.
I was a squadron commander as Fighter Wing 13, responsible for the Viggens intercepting the SR-71. We operated very much in the Baltic Sea, and we had many contacts with SR-71, but we understood that it was a very severe situation with an SR-71 going down over Swedish territory. We were afraid it was going to crash, and we ordered the Viggens to contact it, intercept, and to follow it, escort through the Baltic Sea. It was a very severe situation with a Blackbird in problems outside Russia, going in over Swedish territory, and also leaving Swedish territory, going over the southern Baltic Sea, very close to East Germany. And we ordered two fighter Viggens and QRA Viggens with weapons on board to follow, to be very near the SR-71 on its way south to NATO. I think it's very important. It's very important because it's about the relations between the nations and its security policy and the meaning of what we represent in the US Air Force and the Swedish Air Force at that time, but also today. And today it's very important that we remember what happened and the roles we had, but it's mutual respect and to be professional.
It wasn't too much after we leveled off that we looked out the left window, and there were two fighter aircraft coming at us from the east in the direction of the Soviet Union. First thought was, this could be it. We didn't know what the Soviets' intent could have been, but we knew it probably wasn't good. And as the aircraft got closer, I kept looking, and I recognized these aren't Soviet markings, and it's not a Soviet jet. And I got a little closer, and I saw the Swedish markings and knew it was a Swedish Viggen, two Swedish Viggens. They had actually responded to our emergency squawk in the aircraft, and they rendezvoused with us and escorted us, continued south. It wasn't more than a few minutes after the Swedish aircraft pulled on our left wing that a MiG-25 pulled up to a couple miles to the left of them.
My role, I was the commander of the first, what do you call it, wing pair that came out in the area. We were doing a formal practice peacetime operation, and we were asked from the fighter controller if we could make an identification of an aircraft with a special interest. We started to get southbound to intercept what I thought was the SR-71, who normally flew around the Baltic Sea and head out southbound between the island Öland and Gotland. So we make heading for the southern part of the island Öland to make a northbound 180 attack on the SR-71. But as soon as I asked if he could state position, he said that, where is he? He said it was 30 kilometers north of Hoburg. I thought that must be wrong, because it should have meant 30 kilometers north of Gotska Sandön. So I asked him again, can you state position? And he said, Hoburg. And I asked him then, do you mean that he's over Swedish territory? Yes, he said. So then we went supersonic back to him and find him in the clouds south of Hoburg. I identified him, and I stayed behind on top, because it was very interesting to see that aircraft from above. So I stayed behind and over him, and my wingman, Christer, stayed on his right side to make some note of his aircraft number.
I was the wingman to the first two aircraft that came into the SR-71. Okay, I came in to get the numbers, and I said to myself, this man is in trouble, in real trouble. So I thought that he was going to declare an emergency and turn in over Sweden. But they kept on going south. And we took the numbers and so on, and we were unarmed at that time. We were just there for practicing, and all this occurred. And then the QR pair was inbound, and we were running on bingo fuel. So we turned back to our base, and that's basically what happened.
My role, I was the squadron commander for 62 squadron, number 62 squadron, and we were responsible for the QRA unit. And that very morning I was one of the pilots flying. I had a wingman who is not here today, but Boo. And we was holding the QRA pair based in Ängelholm on the west coast of Sweden. So that's what's my role that very morning. First of all, I was a little surprised, because I was asked to raise the alert from 5 minutes to jump into the aircraft. And as soon as I got into aircraft, scramble. And I understood that this must be quite urgent, because the weather was really lousy. It was a drizzle, foggy, so it was not sure we could get back to the base after taking off. So my first reaction was, this must be very important. So we started up eastwards, climbed to roughly 20,000 feet, flew as fast as I could above the territory, because I couldn't get supersonic by close enough. And then it took just a few minutes, and then I was in the Baltic. Got the SR-71 in sight. And it was really tricky to reduce the speed, because it was flying quite slow. So I had to make a big turn. So I know the guys from the SR-71, I thought we were coming from the east, but we came from the west. So I had to go on. I went on to the SR-71 on its right side, because I didn't know if they were aware that we were there. So I just did a flyby quite close to the cockpit, show my national registration, and went backward, and my wingman went forward. And we kept that position. I followed him for 6 minutes, I think.
And then we had to abort the mission when we came to Danish territory. So we had to go back to our base.
I found out later from NSA that they were under orders to force us to land. They wanted the aircraft or to shoot us down. So without the Swedish Viggens rendezvousing with us and escorting us, we wouldn't have made it home alive. Again, we're here today to celebrate and pay to recognize the amazing courage and valor of the four Swedish pilots. And I say four because initially it was two, but they were starting to run out of fuel and ended up having to go back to their home base when two other Swedish Viggens came up and escorted us, continued south and then to the west towards West Germany, which is where we landed. Again, I don't think they knew the threat that was, or what had actually happened at the time. They just knew they saw an SR-71 in trouble and they came to our rescue. Again, I found out from NSA later on that the Russians or the Soviets had actually launched as many as 20 aircraft, hoping that the Viggens would have to pull off and we would be all alone. And they would have, I wouldn't be here today telling you this story. So that's why it's so great to be able to recognize the events of that day and what the Swedish Viggen pilots did. I gave them all a hug and thanked them. I said, it's not often that you get to actually meet somebody that saved your life. And I asked them, I said, have you ever had someone save your life? And they said, well, I'm not sure. I know exactly who saved my life, and I'm with them right now. So I would like to add one thing. My front-seater pilot, Duane, Noll, I was not able to be here today. He had just had back surgery, but he wanted to make sure that everyone knew he sends his regards, but also his congratulations and thank you to the Swedish pilots as well.
As responsible for the intercept, the manage command structure, high-level management on Sweden when this happened. And we got so worried because if you have this at 70,000 feet and it goes down with a descent speed of 40,000 feet a minute from this, going down, it's not going like this. It's going like this. And then they managed to recover. And we were very worried that it was going to crash. And we felt the responsibility also to handle the situation. And there is a meaning of that we ordered the Viggens to be very close to the SR-71 on this very dangerous way out of the Baltic. Like that.
It's a fantastic opportunity to see what's happening. It's great, actually. It's more than 30 years ago, but it's amazing to be here today. Great opportunity to say thank you and to see the guys who were there.
First of all, very honored to get in the air medal, and I'm really astonished that what happened 31 years ago should end up in a ceremony like this. Never could imagine.
After more than 30 years of highly classified missions, the United States Air Force permanently retired the SR-71 in 1998.